Welcome, everyone. It's great to see everyone. This is the last in our series on food, and we're going to have a great night tonight, learn a lot. And thank you all for coming. I'm J.P. Jones. I'm the Dean of the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences. I have a few people I need to thank before I begin to introduce tonight's speaker. Up here we have a list of all of our community sponsors, and I'd like to especially thank tonight, on our last night, Craig Sundberg and all the people at the Fox Theater who have made the security and the getting people in and out and so on such a great process. And thank you for having us downtown. Thank you, Craig. Our supporting sponsors include Kaler Construction Company, Desert Diamond, Casinos and Entertainment, Downtown Kitchen and Cocktails, Downtown Tucson Partnership, the UA Institute of the Environment, and Arizona Public Media. And I want to especially call out AZPM because behind me over here every night that we've been meeting, and for all I know also in the Modern Language Building, are people who are turning the dials and running the cameras and making sure that this fine series of lectures can be broadcast not only to Green Valley and to Phoenix and to Flagstaff and to San Agustin Mercado, but really all over the world. Anyone can just come in and simulcast right on the web. And so we're especially grateful for Arizona Public Media's support of this series. Our lecture sponsors include Cox Communication, the Southwest Foundation for Education and Historic Preservation, and the Zuckerman Family Foundation, and I would like to thank all three of those sponsors for their support. Tonight's food sponsor, sponsors, I should say, both come from the Mercado San Agustin. Depending on the way you're standing, north or south, or where you live in town, they're either the origin or the terminus of the modern streetcar. I'd like to thank Tana Fryer from Blue, a wine and cheese stop, and also from Augustine Kitchen, Ryan Clark. Ryan is the chair of Slow Food Southern Arizona, and so we're really delighted that Augustine Kitchen is a supporter of the series. Our title sponsors, as you know, if you've been coming every Wednesday night, include the Arizona Daily Star, U of A's Office of Student Affairs and Enrollment Management, and our Magellan Circle donors in the college, as well as Tucson Medical Center. And I'd like to give Julia Strange from the Tucson Medical Center an opportunity to come up here and say a few words about TMC's role in community wellness. Julia? For the last several weeks, I've been mentioning Mary Atkinson, who's the Director of Wellness, and Julia Strange, who has got the coolest title, I think, in the world, which is VP for Community Benefit. I mean, if you can't want to be a VP for Community Benefit, I don't know what. Julia's position is to help TMC in the areas of strategic communication, government relations, and community outreach. And TMC has been very active in establishing a new department of wellness that Mary runs, and also in lots of different kinds of programming that they're bringing to the community for a holistic, I would even say integrative approach to wellness. So thank you so much, Julia, for coming up and saying a few words and for the support of TMC for this series.
Thank you very much. And I do have the best job in town, at least, if not broader than that. We are thrilled to sponsor this series again. It's been successful and very timely. It's evident that food is the foundation of our community, and it's really is what ties us together. And I'll give you a very short story about why that's so pivotal to me and my experience. I grew up in rural Indiana, and my mother used to have this massive garden. And we had a huge family, but there was no way we could ever eat all of the food she grew. So I was like this tall, and she would send me out with my red wagon, and I would have to carry the vegetables all around to all the elderly people in the neighborhood. And I, of course, would have to sit down with them and talk to them while they picked out their vegetables, and it would take me all day to deliver this. And then in the winter, we flipped it, and Mom would say, please go out to all of these elderly households, these households in the community, and go and get your hot chocolate and cookies from them. So that was better, because I went around and I got hot chocolate and cookies. And then I would have to sit down with them and talk to them while I drank the hot chocolate and cookies. What I didn't realize at the time was that what she was doing was connecting the community. She was sending me out to check on these friends, these family members, to make sure they were okay and they were still connected. And she did that through food. So that, in my mind, that's a good example. And here we are tonight talking about food as a community and how it brings us together. As Tucson's community hospital, we are focused on supporting activities that will improve the health outcomes of our broader community. And that extends all the way throughout Southern Arizona. We are very proud to be a sponsor. We are focused, and while we are very capable and have the latest technology to take care of the most critical illnesses, we're also committed to making sure that our community doesn't need our service any sooner than that should be required. We are endeavoring to empower people to learn and engage in their health and to really take charge and make their life as healthy and fulfilling as it can be. So we're thrilled to be here, thrilled to be part of this series, and I'm looking forward to tonight's lecture.
Thank you.
Thank you, Julia. Now it's a great pleasure of mine to introduce tonight's speaker, Dr. Victoria Mises. She is a professor of family medicine, community medicine, and public health at the University of Arizona, and she's also an attending physician at the Arizona Health Sciences Center and UMC, and she's also, finally, the executive director of the Arizona Center for Integrative Medicine. She received her BA at Barnard College and her medical degree, her MD, at the University of California at San Francisco. Her research is on women's health, nutrition, cancer, and healthy aging. And she has, in her capacity as the executive director of the Center for Integrative Medicine, well, what is integrative medicine? I had to look that up, of course. It integrates physicians and patients and the care of patients. It integrates the body with the mind, the spirit, the community, and the environment. And it takes an integrative approach to finding solutions, which are both traditional and modern medicine, natural and non-invasive. So it's a holistic approach to healthcare and to wellness. In her capacity as the executive director, Dr. Mises has trained thousands of physicians and nurses and other healthcare professionals in primary care integrative medicine, and she has also conducted scores of studies on the clinical and cost effectiveness of integrative medicine. She's a co-editor of a book titled Women's Integrative Health, which means that she's covered a little more than half the planet, and that's not bad. And she has a new book out with Scribner in 2013 called Be Fruitful. And for those of you who are thinking of having children, then it's a book to buy. For those of you who are thinking of having grandchildren, it's probably also a book to buy. Her work has been funded by NIH, by the Department of Education, and by the Weill Foundation, the Lovell Foundation, and the Adolf Coors Foundation. She has a long list of awards and is regularly asked to speak all over the world on integrative medicine. Two of my favorites is the fact that she has been voted since 2006 one of America's best doctors, which I always thought was a ploy to get ads into airline magazines, but in fact is a real award. And she also has a very, very long list of public outreach activities, interviews, media interviews, stories about her in women's health magazines like Self, at the Today Show, Science Friday, with Plato and others. And so it's a great privilege of mine to welcome her to the stage. Please give Dr. Mises a warm welcome. Victoria?
Thank you, JP. Thank you. Well, good evening, everybody. So you have already heard four talks about food. You've heard about climate change, and you've heard about culture. You've heard about the history of food in the Roman Empire. And you've heard about our own local history and issues about sustainability. Is anybody wondering what they should eat? Is anyone a little confused about what to eat? So it's my hope this evening to answer that question, what should we be eating? And to bring clarity where there's confusion. Now, I'm an integrative physician, and so it won't surprise you to hear that I'm going to speak about health. In my clinical practice at the Arizona Center for Integrative Medicine, and my reading of the research, I can tell you that there's no doubt that food is a foundational part of our health, and it's a driver of our good health. But I also want to tell you that I firmly believe that food should be a source of great pleasure in our lives. And it's also what gives us the fuel that makes us feel vital and alive. I'm going to talk about all those things. I'm also going to talk about obesity, because so many people ask me questions about that as we face this crisis as a nation. So I'm going to ask for your indulgence a few times this evening. Now I'd like you to close your eyes, if you're willing, and imagine comfort food. Go ahead and let it really come fully into your imagination. Notice if you can smell a smell associated with your favorite food. Taste the taste. The texture, perhaps the crunch in your mouth when you chew on it. Go ahead and really savor this experience. Enjoy it. Is it a meal you had last night, or maybe last week, or maybe it goes all the way back to your childhood? Okay, now open your eyes, and I'd like to hear from a few of you what came to mind. Anybody? Mashed potatoes, peanut butter, hot chocolate, mac and cheese, spaghetti. So these are common ones. Did anyone have Brussels sprouts? A fresh green salad, right? So it's a reminder that we don't only eat for fuel. We eat for pleasure. We eat in celebration. We eat for our holidays. Thanksgiving's coming up. We eat to nourish ourselves in a lot of different ways. And we also eat to comfort ourselves. This says, today I will live in the moment, unless the moment is unpleasant, in which case I will eat a cookie. So we eat also to de-stress and to self-nourish. It's wise to remember all of these different relationships with food. Here's another one. Food is my enemy. These words were spoken to me verbatim by a patient of mine. He had struggled very hard to lose 100 pounds, and he had gained back about 60 of them. And this is how he felt. Anyone else feel this way about food? It's not so uncommon. This comes from the New Yorker magazine, and it's titled The Last Thanksgiving. And if you look around the table, you can see can't have salt, lactose intolerant, vegetarian, vegan, macrobiotic, fanatic traditionalist, on a cleanse, strictly kosher, ultra-picky gourmet, allergic to gluten. How have we gotten to this? Does anyone feel this way? I know when I invite people to my home, I always say, do you have any food needs or preferences that I should be aware of? You know, the word companion comes from the Latin come and panis. And what it literally means is with bread. In other words, who did we share bread with? Who did we break bread with? It's not so easy to break bread together anymore, is it? This says, they revised the food pyramid again. Eat whatever you want. Nobody listens to us anyway. You know, people get very frustrated. They say, look, you know, you experts, you can't agree on anything anyway, so why should we listen to you? And, you know, if we read the headlines, it's easy to see why we would believe that. One week, fiber is going to help prevent colon cancer, and then the next week on the headlines, it says fiber makes no difference. The most recent one, saturated fat. For years, we've been told saturated fat will increase our risk of cardiovascular disease. Now, not so clear anymore. But I do want to tell you that as someone who has spent a lot of time thinking about nutrition, and at the Arizona Center for Integrative Medicine, we put on an annual nutrition conference. And each year we invite some of the leading nutritional scientists, chefs, researchers, clinicians, registered dietitians. So I have been listening to and meeting with experts. We're about to do our 11th one in Phoenix for a long time, and there is great consensus. And I hope this evening to share with you some of the places where indeed there is agreement, some of the controversy, and some of the places where, you know, we just don't know. So Michael Pollan is famously quoted with these seven words: eat food, not too much, mostly plants. It's very good advice, but maybe not quite enough advice. And in fact, he went on to write a whole book to explain what these seven words mean. There's a tremendous amount of confusion right now about what diet we should be advising. If you look at the Mediterranean diet, it's almost 40% fat. Now, we like fat. Fat is satiating. It tastes good. It carries flavor across our tongue. And it's supposed to prevent heart disease. The Ornish diet is less than 10% fat. It's also supposed to prevent heart disease. The Campbell diet tells us to eat no animal products, but the Atkins diet, South Beach, Paleo to some extent, say to eat mostly animal products. There's the raw foods diet that says cooking destroys enzymes, and the alkaline diet that says acidic foods will alter your body's pH and make you sick. And then we have this huge gluten-free movement that say grains are the root of inflammation, and inflammation is a common cause, the underlying cause of many different illnesses. Yeah. So I want to start with the reason we have all these diets. For most people, it's to help you lose weight. So what do we know about weight loss? Well, I can tell you that there have been over 16 well-designed studies that look at different diets: Atkins, Zone, Weight Watchers, Ornish, Learn, all of these different low-carb, high-carb, low-fat, high-fat, and they put people on these diets for up to 2 years. And people lose about the same amount of weight, actually. It depends mostly on how adherent they are to the diet that they're assigned to. Interesting. So do diets work? Well, some things that we learn make good sense. Weight Watchers, as an example, has taught us to be really aware of portion size. And being aware of our portions is a good idea. Brian Wansink is a researcher at Cornell University, and he's done a lot of research on the unconscious decisions we make all the time about what we eat. He says that the average person believes they make about 15 food decisions a day, but actually we make closer to 200. Many of them we're not aware of. If the person sitting next to us is eating faster, we eat faster. If they eat more, we eat more. The size of our plate makes a difference. If we eat on a larger plate, we eat about 30% more food than if we choose a smaller plate. He did a very interesting study. He invited people to a movie, and he served them popcorn. Some people got big bowls of popcorn. Some people got small buckets of popcorn. The people who got the big buckets ate 53% more. This was not delicious popcorn. It was 5 days old. So it wasn't that it was yummy. It was this unconscious response we have to a larger portion. So here's a tip: smaller plates. Here's another one. Drinking your calories may lead you to gain weight, including if it's a very healthy beverage. I'll talk about soda in a little bit. Why is that? And this is controversial. Not all studies find this. But it turns out that when we drink our calories, we often don't get the same sense of satiety as when we chew and swallow and have the texture of food and the experience of eating. So you might consider not drinking your calories. Stick to water or to herbal teas. We'll talk about coffee in a minute. So this is the simplistic understanding of obesity. It has to do with the second law of thermodynamics, which basically says we conserve energy. And so when you simplify obesity, and by the way, most of our policy is designed to look at just this law, we think about how many calories are you eating and how much energy are you expending. And you expend energy a certain amount through your basal metabolic rate, but mostly through your physical activity. So what are you eating? How active are you? And as a country, we have tried to get people to eat less or to move more. Okay, it's good advice, but it may be that we have completely oversimplified obesity. And so I want to go through some of the recent thinking about obesity. Some of these principles that I'm going to cover also have to do with health and vitality. And there are more than these five, but I'm going to start here. So epigenetics, we all know about genetics, and we know about the genome. Epigenetics are the things above the genes that turn the genes on and off. And it turns out that a lot of epigenetics has to do with our lifestyle, and especially what we eat. Isocaloric is not the same as isometabolic. What does that mean? Well, we pretty much have been taught that a calorie is a calorie is a calorie, and that regardless of what you eat, it's going to essentially have the same effect. But what newer science is teaching us, and Robert Lustig at UCSF is one of the people who's done a lot of this research, is that what we eat determines how we metabolize the food and whether we lay down fat or whether we burn those calories. And I'll give you an example. Thermoregulation. We live in Tucson, and in the summer, when it's hot, we sometimes lose our appetite. In cold places in the winter, people shiver to maintain their body temperature, and they burn more calories that way. Well, now we have central air conditioning and central heating. And so we've lost this drive that helped us maintain our weight before we got so comfortable. The microbiome. The microbiome has to do with the bacteria that live in our intestine. Now, when you hear about bacteria in the intestine, you may think about E. coli and the dangers of bacteria. But it turns out that many of these bacteria are actually critical to our good health. They form part of the basis of our immune system, and they help us digest our food. And so I'll speak more about the microbiome. And then environmental chemicals. We're exposed to many. There are over 80,000 industrial chemicals in use today. And unlike medicines, they don't have to be studied. They're just released by the chemical companies. And the EPA actually has to prove that there's something dangerous to our health. The bar is so high that not even asbestos has been outlawed, even though it's a known carcinogen. So we're exposed to a lot of these chemicals. Some of them are endocrine disruptors. What that means is that they alter the normal hormonal function in our body. And some of that modification makes it easier for us to gain weight and harder for us to lose weight. Okay, so who's seen this picture before? These are genetically identical mice. They don't look identical, do they? No, these are agouti mice. Agouti mice are bred to overeat, to get fat, to develop high blood pressure, obesity, cancer, diabetes. But you could see that there is a slimmer brown mouse there, even though they're genetically identical. So why is that? The brown mouse's mother was fed a feed that had supplemental B12 and folate in it. B12 and folate are methyl donors. Remember your biochemistry, a carbon with three hydrogens? That's okay, you don't have to remember biochemistry. When we fully methylate the gene, we do not express what these mice were bred to express, which is obesity. So the B12 and folate protects them from that genetic destiny. And the same is true for us. Our lifestyle choices can modify whether or not genes are turned on and off. Another thing that prevents methylation of genes is bisphenol A, which is an environmental chemical that's in plastics, the linings of cans, the thermal receipts that we get when we pay for something. So we're exposed to a variety of things, and we can make choices that turn our genes on and off. So you drink a can of Coke, you eat an avocado. Let's say for a moment, same number of calories. What does your body do with those calories? Well, if you drink a can of Coke, and by the way, this could be a fresh glass of orange juice too, you get a rapid bump in blood sugar. That's followed by a rapid bump in insulin. Insulin is the hormone that's secreted by your pancreas to keep your blood sugar normal, stable. When your body can't do that anymore, you develop diabetes, which is elevated blood sugars. So when you eat an avocado, you don't get that bump in blood sugar. Because of the fat, because of the fiber, you get a much more gradual rise in blood sugar that's followed by a much more gradual rise in insulin. The sugar from that soda leads your body to metabolize those calories into fat. Insulin tells the body to store calories as fat. And so the message is very different, and that's why the metabolic effect of rapidly digesting carbohydrates, and it's not just soda or orange juice, it's also a baguette, as an example. Things that are made from flour, white flour or whole wheat flour, they're rapidly digested, they bump up your blood sugar, they bump up your insulin. And that's one of the reasons for the popularity of diets like Atkins or Paleo or South Beach. So besides sugar, our metabolism can also be altered by trans fats. Now, trans fats are coming out of our diet, But you can still see on the label of many foods partially hydrogenated oils. When you see that, think trans fats and avoid that food. Alcohol also affects our insulin signaling and signals us to lay down calories as fat. And then two other lifestyle factors: chronic insomnia, chronically not getting enough sleep, or chronic stress will also alter the way in which we metabolize our fat and lead us to gain weight. Okay, true or false? Nuts can help you lose weight. Raise your hand if you believe it's true. Okay, raise your hand if you think nuts make you gain weight. All right, I'll tell you, I was always taught nuts would make me gain weight. You know, I grew up in the era of fat makes you fat. Don't eat things that are fattening. But the evidence is pretty strong, actually, that eating nuts is one of the things that contributes to weight loss over time. Not necessarily intuitive. Here's another one. True or false? Artificial sweeteners help you lose weight. Who believes that they do? Artificial sweeteners, do they help you lose weight? Yes? No. Okay, it's controversial. We don't know for sure. So let me give you a little bit of interesting thoughts about this. So you drink a diet soda, as an example, and your tongue tastes sweet. And a signal goes to your brain, expect sweet, expect sugar, expect to have to metabolize those calories. So the pancreas starts to produce hormones, getting ready for digestion. But then no calories actually come. Well, suddenly your body starts rooting around because it's looking for the calories to metabolize, and so you go and you reach for something else. But a study came out a couple of months ago in Nature that was really interesting. They fed rats artificially sweetened beverages, and they found within 2 weeks the rats had abnormalities in insulin. They were insulin resistant, which is a precursor to diabetes. And they found the reason for it were changes in the microbiome, those bacteria that live in our intestines. They did a study of just a few people, and they found half the people responded identically to the rats in terms of the changes in the microbiome and the changes in insulin sensitivity. So we don't know for sure whether this is true for everybody, just for some people, but clearly artificial sweeteners are not a good strategy for everybody. This slide says, honor thy bacteria. Why do I write that? Well, it turns out we're 90% bacterial. In our body, 90% of the cells are bacterial. 99% of our genes are bacterial. How could that be? Well, bacteria are very, very small. And as I said, these bacteria serve a very important function in terms of our immune system and digestion. So how do we establish and maintain a normal microbiome? Well, first of all, it begins when we're born. If we're born vaginally, we come through our mother's birth canal, and we are colonized with vaginal bacteria. But if we're born by cesarean section, we come out through a surgical incision in our mother's abdomen, and we're colonized by skin bacteria. About a third of births right now in the United States are by cesarean section. Cesarean section can be life-saving, but probably 33% is a bit high. And there are consequences. Besides the increased risk to the baby and the mother of infection, and when a baby's colonized with skin bacteria, they have higher rates of obesity. As a child and also as an adult, they have higher rates of allergies and asthma. And so we should encourage normal vaginal deliveries as often as possible. The microbiome is formed within 4 days. The baby's born, mother starts to breastfeed. In the breast milk are these human milk oligosaccharides. They're a kind of carbohydrate that we as humans cannot digest. So you'd say from an evolutionary perspective, that's very strange. Why would we waste those precious calories to have something we can't digest? Well, they are prebiotics. They feed the bifidobacteria and the bacteroides that are beginning to colonize the microbiome of that developing baby. We also take antibiotics and we use antibacterial cleansers. Now again, antibiotics can be life-saving, but sometimes we use them a bit too frequently. And when we use them, we don't just knock out the infection, we can knock out the healthy bacteria in our guts, and it's not necessarily so easy to replenish that. Here's another interesting thing. In animal husbandry, we use antibiotics as growth promoters. In other words, we give antibiotics not just because an animal has an infection, but also to get them to gain weight. Farmers know this. This is one of the ways to be more profitable, because a fatter animal brings more dollars in the marketplace. And then we've probably altered our microbiome in other ways. Cooking, the introduction of agriculture, which is why the paleo people say we should go back to the time before agriculture. I'll talk more about paleo in a bit. And the processed foods that we eat also stimulate the growth of a different microbiome. Okay, now I promised some of this talk would be about the pleasure of eating. So here's one of mine. By the way, one of my comfort foods, chocolate. So chocolate is good for us for lots of reasons. It lowers blood pressure. It produces in us these chemicals that enhance our mood. But chocolate also helps support the lactic acid bacteria in our intestines. So they're good for our microbiome. Here are some other ways to support our microbiome. That's a bowl of yogurt. So yogurt, fermented foods, things like pickles, sauerkrauts, kimchi, all of these have healthy bacteria that may help support a healthy microbiome. Probiotics. We know probiotics can be helpful in some kinds of medical conditions. What we don't know is if they can permanently restore a healthy microbiome. So, is this what's coming next to a store near you? You know, we've been doing fecal transplants for a number of years. We do fecal transplants in people who have C. difficile, Clostridium difficile, a very bad intestinal infection. The fecal transplants work better than antibiotics. We also sometimes use them for people with bad inflammatory bowel disease. But interestingly enough, there have been studies in rodents. If you take the fecal material from a lean mouse and you put it into a fat mouse, the fat mouse becomes lean. And vice versa. If you take the fecal material from a sick mouse and put it into a healthy mouse, the healthy mouse may become sick, and vice versa. Last month, a study came out, the first pilot study out of Mass General at Harvard, where they had about 20 people who had this C. difficile infection. It's a very bad infection that can be life-threatening. And they gave people fecal material and pills, and 90% of the people responded to these poop pills. So keep a watch on this, and we'll see. Lastly, I want to talk about some of the invisible triggers of obesity. Bisphenol A, it's in the lining of our cans, it's in plastics, it's in thermal receipts. 90% of us have bisphenol A when our urine is tested. When they looked at children, the children with the highest levels of bisphenol A in their urine had 5 times the obesity of the children with the lowest levels. So this is the kind of endocrine disrupting effect that may be contributing to the obesity crisis we're seeing in our children. This is an association. In other words, we don't know that it caused it, but it is something to watch for, and we want to minimize our exposure to these endocrine-disrupting chemicals. A recent study has found that women who carry a little extra weight live longer than the men who mention it. Actually, this is true. there have been studies that show that people with a body mass index of between 30 and 35, which overweight is considered a BMI over 30, actually do have better longevity. So perhaps our obsession with weight is also just that. All right, let's now move to vitality. Virginia Woolf is famously quoted as having said, one cannot think well, love well, sleep well if one has not dined well. So what is vitality? It's this sense of being fully alive, of having vigor, physical and mental, abundant energy, resilience. It's something we all want. And food is one of the drivers that gives it to you. Let me show you a little bit of how this works. This is a little more biochemistry. So imagine you eat that power lunch, a protein-rich meal. Tyrosine, which is an amino acid, will rise in your blood and also in your brain. And it is converted into dopamine. Dopamine may be stored in your nerve cells or converted to norepinephrine, and it gives you this sense of alertness and enhanced energy. In contrast, you reach for a bowl of pasta, and this carbohydrate-rich meal tells the pancreas to release insulin. All of your amino acids are going to leave your blood and enter the muscle cells, except for tryptophan. Tryptophan will remain in the blood and also enter the brain, where it is converted into serotonin. And serotonin gives us this sense of calm and uplifted mood. Now, most of you are probably familiar with SSRIs. They're antidepressants like Prozac, Zoloft, Paxil. SSRI stands for Selective Serotonin Reuptake Inhibitor. So things that help us maintain higher levels of serotonin. And that's what carbs do. And that's one of the reasons we crave them and we reach for them, because they have this effect of enhancing our mood. Okay, here's a second pleasure message. Who here loves their morning cup of coffee? Okay, this is the good news. Unless you are bothered by insomnia or it gives you GI distress, coffee is good for you. You heard it here. Coffee reduces the risk of diabetes. It reduces the risk of most kinds of cancer, of liver disease. It helps protect against Parkinson's. And in a study last year, it was shown to reduce all-cause mortality. So coffee is something that you can continue to enjoy. All right. Those of you who have not yet eaten your box of raisins, please take it out. And I'd like you to take one raisin out of the box and hold it in the palm of your hand. Just one. And go ahead and look at that raisin. Now, I'm going to stop calling it a raisin because I want for a moment for you to have an experience as if you have never seen this object before. So look at it as if for the first time ever you're seeing this object. And notice its shape. Notice the grooves in it, the way the light hits it. You may want to pick it up between two fingers and really examine it. Feel its texture. Bring it up to your nose and give it a smell. Okay, and now I'm going to ask you to bring it to your mouth and put it in your mouth, but don't bite it. Notice how your hand knows just what to do. And go ahead and move it around in your mouth. Experience it with your tongue. And when you're ready, but very consciously, take one bite of your raisin. And notice the flavor that comes out into your mouth. This is a little funny. It's okay, but just an exercise. Bear with me. Chew it on a little bit. And notice the taste. Maybe you're having a little more saliva production. And when you're ready, when you notice the impulse to swallow coming, slowly, gradually, go ahead and swallow the raisin. So this is a mindful eating exercise. Imagine if you brought this quality of attention, at least to your favorite foods, to a wonderful piece of dark chocolate, to dessert, maybe something else that you really enjoy eating, as opposed to eating in the car or in front of the television where perhaps you don't even notice, but the food is suddenly gone. Experience the pleasure of your foods by eating mindfully. In contrast, this is another experiment. And why is Cookie Monster so upset? Well, he's been asked to go off gluten. Any of you off gluten? Anyone know anyone who's off gluten? Yeah, a lot of people. This is a multi-billion dollar industry of people who are eating gluten-free. So let me tell you about a recent study that was done. It was done on people who had irritable bowel syndrome. And they had perceived that they were sensitive to gluten, and so they decided to go off gluten. In this 6-week study, the group was divided in half. They were randomly divided, and half of them had 2 slices of bread and a muffin each day that actually had gluten in it. And the other half, the placebo group, had 2 slices of bread and a muffin that had no gluten. And they taste tested them and you couldn't tell the difference, which is a little hard to believe because gluten-free bread doesn't taste so great. But maybe they made the regular bread not taste so good. Anyway, then they did symptom records at the end of each week. And what they found was for the 20 people who were on the gluten-free diet, the true diet, the placebo diet, they continued to do well. The people who had gotten actual gluten in their bread and muffin started complaining of abdominal pain, of bloating, of a change in their stool consistency, and interestingly enough, of fatigue. That was actually the most common symptom. And I raise that because in my experience, people sometimes have a food that they're sensitive to or intolerant of that causes subtle symptoms. And so I ask those people in my clinical practice to experiment with an elimination diet. The most common food triggers, and these are not true allergies. This is not someone who's deadly allergic to peanuts or shellfish or some other kind of tree nut. These are subtle symptoms. It may be fatigue, bloating, constipation, headaches, brain fog, skin rashes, joint aches, a variety of symptoms. So I ask people to go off of the suspected food for a 3-week period, and I ask them to be religious about it. Very strict. The most common foods are wheat, dairy, citrus, corn, soy, eggs. But it could be anything that for some reason you've developed an intolerance to. And notice at the end of those 3 weeks if you feel better. Do you have less headache, fatigue, bloating, etc.? And then re-challenge. Go back on that suspicious food. And if the symptoms come back, you might decide that that's a food you want to avoid. We'll work for low-calorie, all-natural, locally grown, gluten-free, whole food with minimal packaging. Is this how we're going to eat from here on? What do we know about health, and what can we recommend? So in this slide, you see two very different meals. The one on the lower left is the Okinawan diet, and the one in the upper right is an example of the Mediterranean diet. These are two diets that have been studied and some of the healthiest diets on the planet that we know of. And yet they're really quite different. And I say that because I don't believe there's a one-size-fits-all. I think different diets are appropriate for different people. It may have to do with our genetics. It may have to do with cultural differences. It may have to do with how our microbiome formed. The Okinawan diet and the Mediterranean diet have some things in common. They both include a lot of plants, a lot of vegetables, a lot of fruits. And they both have fish. But there are also some substantial differences. The Okinawan diet is really low in calories. It's low in fat. And it includes some seaweed and kind of slimy foods that we as Americans aren't really that used to eating. It's not that familiar to us, and it's labor intensive to produce. But people in Japan who eat this traditional diet have some of the longest lived healthy lives on the planet. Similarly, there's an enormous amount of research supporting the Mediterranean diet. But as Americans, we're not doing such a great job eating a healthy diet. We don't get the whole grains, the vegetables, the fruits, the dairy, the oils, the fiber that we're supposed to, and we get too much solid fat and added sugar. We get too much refined grains. That's the flour that's in so much of our foods, and too much saturated fat. This is the paleo diet. Anyone on the paleo diet? Okay, it's the latest fad. Paleo diet is also called the evolutionary diet, and it's somewhat similar to Atkins and South Beach. As you can see, there's a lot of animal products in it. Hunter-gatherers, right? Our ancestors hunted, and they ate lean meats that they could hunt, and they gathered. And actually, in the paleo diet, about 50% of the diet is plants. They also could find tree nuts and eggs. So here are my thoughts about the paleo diet. On the plus side, when we eat it, we don't eat processed food because there's no grains and there's no legumes. So we're not eating highly processed carbohydrates. And that may be one of the reasons it helps with weight loss. We don't get those bumps in blood sugar and bumps in insulin. It also has been shown, as have Atkins diet and South Beach, to reduce the risk of diabetes. But I have some concerns about the paleo diet. We know that eating red meat, especially, increases the risk of a variety of kinds of cancer: prostate, breast, pancreatic, colon. We also, from a study that came out a few months ago in Cell Metabolism, know that eating red meat, if you're under the age of 65, is associated with increased all-cause mortality. If you're over 65, eating meat actually is good for you, and that is because as we get older, we are at increased risk for frailty, and we have increased needs for protein, and meat can be a source of protein. And then I have a concern about the environmental toxins that are in meat. Meat is at the top of the food chain, and so it bioaccumulates environmental toxins. The animals graze, they eat large amounts of grains, and they bioaccumulate all the pesticides, fungicides, herbicides that might be in those grains. And even if they graze, sadly, we've contaminated our soils too. They bioaccumulate them, and when we eat meat, we're eating these toxins as well. Diana Liverman pointed out to us that eating meat also increases greenhouse gases, so the concern for the environment. Now, this is a food pyramid for the Mediterranean diet. Mediterranean diet has an enormous body of research. As you can see, it includes lots of vegetables, fruits, whole grains, fish. It has dairy, but dairy mostly as yogurt and cheeses, not drinking milk particularly, and very little red meat. Another source of pleasure for many of us, it includes red wine. And the Mediterranean diet has been extensively researched, and we know that it reduces the risk of heart disease, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, cancer, it reduces the risk of depression, and it too reduces all-cause mortality. So from a public health perspective, you often hear about the health benefits of the Mediterranean diet, but it still may not be the perfect diet for everyone in this room. And both the Okinawan diet and the Mediterranean diet are examples of anti-inflammatory diets. They increase omega-3 fatty acids. How do they do that? They have fish in them. They increase antioxidants. How do they do that? The vegetables and fruits. And because they have whole grains and very little processed, we don't get that bump in blood sugar, and so we keep our insulin levels low and stable. They also have these protective phytonutrients. The red wine has resveratrol, the pigments in berries, mushrooms, spices like ginger and turmeric. All of these have anti-inflammatory properties, and anti-inflammation reduces the risk of things like heart disease and Alzheimer and many kinds of cancer. So what do I recommend, and where would most experts agree? If you're interested in losing weight, if you're interested in enhancing your health, your vitality, and your sense of pleasure from your food, there are things to avoid, and all experts agree on the first three. Hopefully, most would agree with the fourth. But processed food, everybody agrees that processed food is unhealthy for us and is a contributor to weight gain. Concentrated sugars, sodas. The only people who argue that this is a contributor to weight gain and to poor health is the soda industry. Everybody else is in agreement that these do contribute to the obesity crisis, and as I've shown you, the metabolic effects drive us towards conditions like diabetes and potentially heart disease. There was a study that came out last year that showed one soda a day increased the risk of a heart attack by 30%. So it's a pro-inflammatory force, and therefore we want to be careful about our concentrated sugars. And then environmental toxins, the big fish, the predatory fish, shark, swordfish, king mackerel, tilefish, to some extent tuna, also bioaccumulate the PCBs, mercury, other contaminants that are in the ocean, and when we eat them, we absorb them into our body. So what should we eat? What can we eat? Oh, first a question, which is worse? Who thinks sugar is worse? Raise your hand. Who thinks high fructose corn syrup? Okay, well, notice the difference. Sugar is 50-50 fructose to glucose, and high fructose corn syrup is 55% to 45%. So not that different. And probably both need to be consumed in great moderation. The World Health Organization says no more than 6 teaspoons of sugar a day. One 16-ounce Coke has 13 teaspoons in it. Protect your microbiome. If I were going to give you a prediction tonight, I would predict that we are going to learn more and more about how essential the health of our microbiome is to our health, to our weight, to a variety of health conditions that we may ultimately suffer from, hopefully can avoid. Protect your microbiome. Eat those fermented foods. Avoid antibiotics unless absolutely necessary. Avoid processed foods. Avoid cans, and that's because the liners have bisphenol A in them, as do plastic. So don't microwave in plastic. Try to use glass or ceramic whenever possible. If cost is a concern, frozen is a much better choice. To reduce your exposure to pesticides and fungicides and herbicides, eat a plant-based diet. You're eating low on the food chain that way. And choose organic if you can afford it. Otherwise, pay attention to the Dirty Dozen and the Clean 15 put out by the Environmental Working Group, which guides our choices. The Clean 15 are the least contaminated vegetables and fruits. And wash and peel your produce also to remove as much of the pesticide residue as you can. Add greens to your diet. One serving of greens reduces the risk of cardiovascular disease by 23%. If you're interested in pleasure, and aren't we all, eat mindfully. Savor the experience. Enjoy every bite. And I would recommend that you be discerning. When the diet sounds really extreme, it's probably worth avoiding. Look for the studies when you're reading the article. How good a study is it? What's the size of the study? How many people were in it? How long was the study carried out for? And follow trusted experts. I follow Walter Willett's work at Harvard, Christopher Gardner at Stanford, Jeff Blumberg at Tufts. And also, you can follow the Arizona Center for Integrative Medicine. We have a great deal of material available on our website that you can look for. We have handouts on gluten-free, if that's an issue for you, on the anti-inflammatory diet. We have online modules if you want to go into much greater depth. And we have this annual conference that I invite all of you to attend if you have an interest in this. It'll be in Phoenix this year, or this coming year, in May. And so in closing, I ask, what intrigued you tonight about eating for health, for vitality, or for pleasure? And what might you wish to do differently? If you're going out to dinner this evening, perhaps talk with your companions. What is it that you might want to commit to? Or on your drive home, what might you change? Thanksgiving is 2 weeks away, and I want to remind all of us that there have always been feasts and feast days in every society, times when we come together with people who we love to eat in celebration, to eat in Thanksgiving. You heard this in Emma Blake's talk, Edible Roman Empire, and you saw those fantastic feasts. And you heard it also from Maribel Alvarez, who spoke about the influence of culture. And we eat what we are. So enjoy your feast. And in the spirit of Thanksgiving, I would like to close with a blessing. May we be blessed to eat food that nourishes our bodies and spirits in the presence of people we love. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Victoria. That was a great lecture. Normally, we would have our speaker on Friday go to the Arizona Star and do the blog, but in this particular case, that event will happen on Wednesday at noon. So go to the Arizona Daily Star website and check that out, and you can ask Dr. Mazes what they did with all the gluten. It's been a great lecture series. I have a couple more people to thank, and some of them will appear here shortly on a slide. The reason that the talks are so good is that we have a fantastic team of people who come together to see the first run of the talks and to offer criticisms and changes. And I'd especially like to thank Gina Murphy Darling from Mrs. Green's World, my good friend Vivi Sabah, SBS Advisory Board member. David Reichland, many of you will remember, was a speaker in the Happiness Series last year and has offered valuable advice, as well as Jennifer Yamnitz from the college, and also John Stobie. And of course, Lydia, who I'm going to embarrass by having her come out here, along with all the speakers who have been in the series. So Emma, Maribel, and Diana, if you'll come up here, thank you for being here. Gary Nabhan. Gary Nabhan couldn't be here tonight. He's with Wendell Berry in Kentucky tonight. Many of you will know Wendell Berry is probably the granddaddy of all foodies in the world. I can't thank all of you enough for not only Lydia, what you've done, but Victoria, Diana, Maribel, and Emma for a really fabulous series. Please join me in thanking all of them. And I think Diana has something else to say.
On behalf of the five lecturers, we wanted to thank Lydia and John. I don't know if he's here. If he's here, he should come up. He did the visuals. He was amazing to work with. And so we wanted to thank them with some Italian wine from Emma and a goodie bag from Native Seed Search for all their help. So.
Many of you are no doubt practiced in the spring going to the science lecture series, and Joaquin Ruiz, who unfortunately couldn't be here tonight, but he did ask me to make sure to invite all of you to the science lecture series, which will begin this spring, January 26th at Centennial Hall, and the topic for that lecture series is life in the universe. And this series is modeled after that one, so we've learned a great deal from the science series, and we're very pleased to have, if you will, taken over the fall and taken over downtown. My good friend Brian Cornelius is out there. He's with Arbar Organic. Grab an Arbar on the way out. Tucson Made, local company, organic fruit and nut bar. It says, and I've also heard, the world's best tasting fruit and nut bar or something like that. I actually didn't know that was a category yet, that UNESCO had given a formal designation to. But speaking of UNESCO, let's keep our fingers crossed. Sometime we hope by the end of the month we'll hear as to whether or not Tucson is a city of gastronomy. Thank you all very much for your attendance.